Following the over 1 month of protest and unrest in the mining town of Linden, His Excellency President Donald Ramotar gave a commitment to establish a commission of inquiry to examine the events in Linden and the death of three protesters and the injuries to several others. Following the establishment of that commission, there have been quite a number of testimonies, etc. Joining me tonight to discuss what would have come out so far from the commission and the constant twists and turns are the Honorable Attorney General and Minister of Legal Affairs, Anand Lal, and People's Progressive Party Civic Member of Parliament, Mr. Manzundir. Gentlemen, welcome.
Thank you and good evening.
Like I said, following what happened and then the establishment of the commission, commitment by the President, maybe what we need to do first, because of all the changes that would have taken place over the life of the commission so far, is to maybe look at what was the intended purpose of this commission.
Edward, first I want to say, and AG, sorry for coming and opening the batting here. I want to say it wasn't after the 1 month long protest that this commission of inquiry was agreed upon by His Excellency. Almost immediately after the shooting,
on July 18,
we had engagements between the government and the parliamentary opposition, and there were general agreements about establishing a commission of inquiry. So the principle was established very early on. Why? Because we wanted to ensure that the facts could be established. And many times, people don't base conclusion on facts. They rush in and make judgment, especially when lawyers want to play politicians. Sorry, Attorney General. But no, this is serious, because immediately that the shootings happened, the three persons were killed, there were all kinds of accusations levied against Minister Rohee and the government. And so this commission was set up to bring out the facts. And it was set up in such a way that regional experts, I'm sure international names would have been considered AGs here, would be on the panel, and the panel would not be dominated by Guyanese legal experts alone, but we have very prominent regional experts sitting on this panel. And I must say, AG, when I visited yesterday in support of Minister Rohee and I saw the manner in which this commission of inquiry was being conducted, I was very impressed and pleased that no detail was left unturned, and the process for me established a lot of confidence that what we are hearing, what we are seeing, and the conclusions would put right what exactly happened in Linden, why it happened, who killed who, and so forth.
Minister, maybe you might be able to give us a bit more in terms of the finer details as it relates to the intended mandate when this commission was established, and maybe the terms of reference a little.
As Manzoor said, after the Linden tragedy, a lot of allegations were flying around. People were misled, and a whole host of dissemination of misinformation and mischief was being peddled and taking place in the country. And obviously the government was concerned, not only about the misinformation, of course, but also to get to the bottom of the tragedy which occurred at Linden. Very early, the very night after the incident, His Excellency President Donald Ramotar made a public announcement expressing condolences and sympathies to the families of the dead persons, and also to the injured persons and to the community of Linden as a whole for what they were going through. And he made an announcement right there and then that he will commission an inquiry into the events. He also said in that disclosure that he will ensure that he engages the opposition in every aspect of this commission. And the process began to establish such a commission. We engaged the parliamentary parties, the APNU, as well as the Alliance for Change, in doing two things. Firstly, in recruiting personnel to constitute this commission. The AFC in particular, Mr. Nigel Hughes in particular, publicly announced that the commission must have on it the presence of people who are outside of Guyana, an international presence. And the APNU joined that chorus. We had no difficulty with that, and we began the process of recruiting people of high integrity and standing and suitable qualifications to sit on this commission. We engaged the process of the CARICOM Secretariat to look into the Caribbean and to recruit for us or to suggest to us persons of, you know, that kind of pedigree and standing and integrity to sit on this panel. And it is in those circumstances that Chief Justice Wolfe, Mr. K.D. Knights, Miss Dana Sitahal, former Chancellor Kennard, and Justice of Appeal Claudette Singh were recruited. We then began an engagement with the opposition to craft the terms of reference which will guide the commission in discharging its mandate. We ensured, through a very painstaking and tedious process, that each aspect of the terms of reference was consensual, so that no one at the end of the process would have any problem with the Commission of Inquiry suffering from any disability in terms of its mandate in discharging the function it was appointed to discharge, which is to investigate fully the incidents which led to the death and destruction, death of these persons, injuries of persons, and destruction to property. That was the mandate of the commission. So, one, in relation to the appointments, you had a very consensual process engaged with the requests of the opposition being taken on board as we proceeded to appoint the commission. And then in terms of the terms of reference, again, we engaged the opposition at every step of the way to ensure that there was consensus in terms of the terms of reference. And then the commission began its work. And if Manzu will permit me to just elaborate a little as to what the opposition's contentions were at the beginning of this commission, what they were telling the Guyanese people, what were their public positions, what were their public postures. They contended as follows. One, that the police shot the people at Linden, killing and injuring the people. Two, that Minister Rohee gave the directions to the police to shoot. Three, that the persons who were on that bridge that day were behaving in a very decent way, that they were peaceful, that they had permission to march, that they were doing nothing unlawful, and that they were in no way provoking the type of response or any type of response of a violent nature. In short, they said that the people were picnicking on the bridge. Those were the contentions of the opposition and Mr. Nigel Hughes in particular as we commenced the commission. Then let us see what the evidence was as the commission unfolded. Contention number one, that the police shot and killed. The police went into the witness box and they denied that they shot and killed anybody, or they shot and injured anybody. Mr. Hughes brought in a pathologist from Trinidad, a Dr. Dainsley, to do the autopsy of the deceased persons. He did not satisfy the legal requirements of getting that person registered as a legal practitioner, as the law requires.
Legal medical practitioner,
as the law requires before that autopsy can be performed. So the man came here and was unable to perform the postmortem. However, he was permitted to witness the postmortem. He was there, Dr. Nihal Singh performed the postmortem and he witnessed the postmortem. The bullets were extracted and placed in a sealed envelope, and then the man left. The man was supposed to come back to say whether anything went wrong with the postmortem. Mr. Hughes was supposed to bring the man back. He has never brought that man back. Never brought the man back. But let me continue. The bullets were then examined by an expert brought in by Mr. Hughes again, a ballistic expert this time, a Mr. Robinson from the United Kingdom. That man examined the bullets which were taken from the body of those persons in a post-mortem operation witnessed by Mr. Hughes's doctor, which he brought in. And that man, who is Mr. Hughes's witness, said to the commission that those shots, which were those pellets which were removed from the bodies of those deceased persons, were 00 buckshot pellets. That was exactly what the police ballistic had confirmed. And that those pellets are not pellets used by the Guyana Defense Force and Guyana Police Force, and all the evidence of the police clearly established that. In fact, the police produced records to show that they stopped using that kind of bullets since 2005 or thereabouts. And all of this is Mr. Hughes bringing these witnesses. Then he brought a videographer. He brought a man who he claims taped what happened in the bridge. He made a lot of publicity out of it that this tape is going to reveal everything. Well, the tape was brought to the commission. And the tape clearly outlined the behavior of the people, the manner in which they assaulted the police, the disorderly conduct, the way in which they burnt and damaged private property. And they did not show that the police did any shooting. Again, this is Mr. Hughes's witness, not the police witness, not the witness from any government agency. This is Mr. Hughes's witness. Thirdly, in relation to Minister Rohee, he said that he will establish that Minister Rohee gave these directions. The evidence clearly established that Mr. Rohee was not in Linden. He said he will produce phone records to show that Mr. Rohee gave directions via the telephone. Well, he produced those phone records. And what those phone records established, that there was a communication between a number registered to the name of Mr. Rohee and a number registered to the name of Mr. Hickin. But the communication took place 2 hours after, or 3 hours after, the shooting is supposed to have taken place. He had Mr. Rohee in the stand yesterday, spending hours trying to extract from Mr. Rohee evidence out of desperation, trying to establish that there was some connection and there were some instructions given. He was unable to do so. In short, every aspect of this case that Mr. Hughes advocated that he will establish from the beginning, he failed abysmally to establish. In fact, and indeed, the evidence which he produced did not support his case. On each occasion, the evidence was injurious to his case. It damaged his case. For example, he is supposed to be representing the three persons, the relatives of the three persons who were shot. To date, he has been unable to place one of those persons in the vicinity of where this protest was taking place. There is one individual who was shot, and no one so far, and Mr. Hughes has been unable to produce any witness who would say, who has said, or who can say that this man was in any way close to where this incident occurred. The point I am making is that from the beginning to the end, to today's date, the AFC, through Mr. Hughes, and the APNU, through Mr. Basil Williams, have collectively and individually failed miserably to prove any form of culpability on the part of the police or on the part of Mr. Rohee in relation to the death and injuries of the persons. What they have managed to prove was that there were other persons who may have shot, and that there was wanton destruction of property. Hundreds of millions of dollars of state property was destroyed, and millions, several million dollars of private property was destroyed. And they produced tapes, and they produced evidence, which can lead a tribunal to conclude that those people who were on the ground that day did those destructive acts. That is what they succeeded in doing in this commission of inquiry. And the people of this country must recognize. So the actions which were taken, which hopefully we will discuss later, taken by Mr. Hughes, must be seen against that background.
You talked about the evidence, initially what was the intention of the Commission of Inquiry and what it turned out to be. Maybe we could spend a little time on what transpired yesterday when the minister...
Before that, Edward, I think we need to also come back and put some other perspectives on the bigger picture, the nastiness of the politics of the AFC and APNU. Since we had the issue of the electricity tariff, and when His Excellency the President met with the leadership of APNU and agreed on a timetable for the phased implementation of increased rates for electricity in the Linden community, and the Prime Minister announced that, the AFC jumped on the bandwagon. Sorry, AFC said no increase and went out and became militant. APNU abandoned their position because AFC appeared to be upstaging them.
No, the AFC accused them of selling out
the
people of Linden. That is what they said.
This time round again, the same thing happened because Nigel Hughes was one of the first to start shouting and condemning Minister Rohee and the police out front, making all the accusation, trying them, the police and Minister Rohee, convicting them, and APNU joined in the quest for the no confidence motion. But what is happening now is this whole story that they spin and cause such a frenzy among decent people, an anger, that story is unraveling. And they are now trying to go on another path to discredit what might come out of the Commission of Inquiry. I don't think it's by accident that they went and did the same thing in Agricola. A shooting, another opportunity, so that they can try and build this case against the police and against Minister Rohee. And in fact, the leader of the opposition came and said he has lost confidence in the police. So this thing has been unraveling now, and as the AG so succinctly put out, what were the issues? What is coming out right now in terms of the hearing in front of everybody? They can't have any more transparency in terms of this commission of inquiry. All of us are packed in there. So this story that they've spun is unraveling. They have to go to another plan, because they feel that they only have an opportunity in chaos, that they don't have an opportunity in order and decency and democracy, but in chaos. So while AG is very technical and straight to the point, and I feel strongly that there are other motives behind the scenes here. I said in this studio some time ago that the AFC has two new strongmen, Moses Nagamutu and Nigel Hughes. And Corbyn, when he opened the Congress to the PNC, talked about the wild men and wild people. Beware of them. And he couldn't be more right. He couldn't be more right. So this story unravels. Its holes are being punched in all the accusations and the convictions which they have unilaterally come to conclusions on. And now they have to put a new spin. So you see the UC Guyanas and whoever writing now from outside. And they only read one set of lines objectivity is a stranger to their conscience. So this stage is being set. And I'm very pleased that NCN would have a program like this, and especially have the AG here, because many times people don't sit back and look at the perspective. And before I yield to AG, I really want to commend Minister Rohee for the testimony he gave yesterday. Commend him, standing firm. And I was proud to be standing in that line in support of him.
Talking about yesterday's testimony, I think one of the things that came out, and maybe Minister Nadalal or Mr. Nadir could shed some light. The initial contention was the minister gave instruction to shoot. But what came out, especially in the cross-examination by Mr. Basil Williams, the minister omitted to give instruction. Maybe that might cause some confusion in the minds of citizens. Maybe you could spend some time on that.
What happened here, Edward, is an implosion took place between the two counsel representing joint interest. All right, so you would expect that there would be commonality of purpose and approach. But you had on the one hand, Mr. Nigel Hughes desperately trying to establish that Mr. Rohee gave directions to the police to shoot. That was his thrust. That was his focus. That was his agenda. That was his mission. On the other hand, in a shocking change of strategy, you had Mr. Basil Williams trying for dear life, trying to establish that Mr. Rohee did not give directions, and that is why Mr. Rohee should be faulted for not giving directions.
Dereliction of duty now.
And he accused Mr. Rohee of dereliction of duty for not giving directions. So you had Nigel Hughes sitting a couple inches away from him, emphatically and strenuously trying to prove that Minister Rohee gave directions, and you have him, Mr. Basil Williams, strenuously asserting that Mr. Rohee did not give directions, and hence he must be held liable for dereliction of duty. So that was what was happening there, an implosion between the two. But what is also important is that the APNU originally, like the AFC, had taken the public position that Minister Rohee gave directions. And here it is. That is what they predicated their no confidence motion on. That is what their public outcry has been from the beginning of this commission. And here it is, when they had the opportunity in the commission, in a tribunal of this type, for the purpose of determining what happened, you have them taking the opposite position, that Mr. Rohee did not give directions, and they're trying to fault him for not doing that. Even the commission recognized that, and at several intervals, the commissioners intervened to point out to them that the commission is confused. Because you have, at various stages of the commission, they had adopted positions which would have led the commission to conclude that this is what they wanted to establish. And when you had the minister himself there, you have a completely different shift. What happened? It happens in cases when you have a bad case. It happens on a regular basis. Is that your original theory and thesis, when you can't get the evidence to support it, and your thesis is being dismantled by the evidence which is adduced, you have to shift. So they have been shifting and shifting and shifting, trying to suit the evidence.
But is because it a shift, or is it a total turnaround?
Well, it was shifting
until
it broke away with Hughes walking away from the commission.
Yes.
And we will deal with that now. Why did he walk away? And what were the circumstances attendant to him walking away? I also wanted to connect the ultimatum which he gave to the president, and I described it then as clumsy, and I still do now, to give a president an ultimatum to dismiss a minister within 48 hours. That must not be discounted from what happened here. You have, as a result of the president correctly ignoring that ultimatum, you had the unfolding of that those atrocities at Agricola, where thousands of people were assaulted and property burnt and all those things that happened there, and we held them responsible. Because when he gave the ultimatum, he said that if the ultimatum is not met, then consequences will follow. Himself and Nagamutu said that. And the consequences did follow. Of course, they really try to wriggle out and try to extricate themselves from the conundrum in which they found themselves. They were unable to do so. But the point is, you have Hughes again taking public entrenched positions, and at the tribunal where you're supposed to establish these things, he cannot. They're dismantling. It takes me also to the number of allegations which they have been making against the government. Take, for example, the corruption allegations. They have created this mountain of corruption against the government. They said it about NISIL, for example. NISIL is an overwhelmingly corrupt organization. And we organized the corruption debates. And we invited them. They sent Mr. Christopher Ram. I signaled to Mr. Christopher Ram that NISIL did 150 transactions. If there is this overwhelming amount of corruption at NISIL, NISIL did 150, not 10, not 5, 150 transactions. The camera is rolling. Just point to one. Don't point to two. Don't point to 10. Don't point to 100. Point to one of the 150 transactions which he says he knows about. Point to one and tell the nation why you're saying that this one is corrupt, or if it is corrupt, and why it is corrupt. For 1 hour, he couldn't do that. The point I am making is that this commission of inquiry presents a unique opportunity for the people of this country to recognize that all these accusations, or most of it, at a minimum, has a lot to do with a political agenda, political rhetoric, aided and abetted by a willing press opposed to the government. So you have this big public momentum taking place and developing and galvanizing. And what are lies are translated into truth. And we don't get the opportunity to answer them like how we get it now in this commission. And that is what the commission is important for also. That here, it, as the public, as the debates were, that here it is that you get an opportunity, the government gets an opportunity to put out its side of the story. Objective people. Now, nobody there are government people. There are two judges, former judges of Guyana. One former chief justice of Jamaica. One, another distinguished jurist from Jamaica, and a law lecturer from Trinidad, a member of the Senate of the Trinidad House of Representatives. Distinguished people, unconnected with the government. Brought here and given the power and the jurisdiction to inquire into this thing. And but when they are presented, when the opposition is presented with the opportunity of prove your case, tell the nation why you're saying that all these things happened and who did them and so on at Linden. What you see is a degeneracy, a complete inability to establish anything that they contended.
Edward, AG said the ultimatum to the president was clumsy. I agree with him, but I want to add, it's the arrogance of the Nigel Hughes in our society that caused all of this chaos. The arrogance, and we saw it today. The force, he's so full of himself. So he gives the president, he and Moses, Nagamutu, an ultimatum. Violence erupts after. And today, he's challenged to have some ethics in how he approaches the commission.
I have two clips of today's events at the Commission of Inquiry. Maybe we could have a look at that.
Yes, we could have. But I want it's very interesting because I had a look at the testimony too. I didn't get a chance to go today. But he was badgering Hicken about how long he spent in the meeting. And Mr. Hicken said, I can't remember. He said in the tape to shoot me. And Justice Wolf told him to withdraw that comment. And he said, what comment? And the justice said to him, the same comment you just made. He said, I can't remember. 2 seconds after. Well, that's the arrogance.
Talk about the meeting a couple of months. Maybe we could take a look at the video.
That wasn't the question.
I'm responding accordingly, sir.
No, I'm saying...
No, sir.
You had no information generally about the bridge ever being blocked.
No, sir.
And you received no intelligence reports that there was a plan to block the bridge.
No, sir.
None whatsoever.
No, sir.
Now, how long did that meeting last?
I cannot recall the exact time the meeting lasted.
Average, a 2-minute meeting, 5 minutes, 15?
No, I want to be precise. I cannot recall the length of time the meeting lasts.
Would you describe it as a very short meeting?
I will describe it as a meeting. In terms of time, I cannot recall.
Okay. That's because you don't recall the events. You don't recall how long it took. You don't recall where you were.
I don't understand. You're asking, I don't recall where I were when I told you that I was in the boardroom of the Ministry of Home Affairs.
I have a difficulty accepting that you don't recall how long the meeting lasted.
I have a difficulty you telling me that I'm saying that I don't know where I was.
Well, you can have as many difficulties as you wish. Was that meeting more than 2 hours?
I can't recall, sir.
Could you have been there for 4 hours?
I cannot recall, sir.
Is it possible that you were there for 4 hours?
I cannot recall that, sir.
All right, but let me suggest that you and the minister were there for 6 hours. Do you deny that?
I don't understand what you're suggesting, sir. If you ask a question, I'll answer you.
You don't understand that suggestion?
Esteemed commissioners, permit me to...
Shoot me?
No.
I put a suggestion to you.
Mr. Hughes, you need to withdraw what you just said. It is totally improper.
Sir, I believe the witness is also being very...
I am concerned with what you said at this point in time. You have no basis for saying something like that.
Sir, I didn't make an accusation. I asked the question.
You asked no question.
So what's the accusation I made, sir?
Whatever you said, you know what you said.
That's why I don't have a clear recollection, sir.
You can't recall?
I can't.
Okay. As a matter of fact, you had said that you had no questions to ask. And if you do not withdraw what you said a moment ago, your cross-examination of this witness will be terminated by the commissioners.
As directed, sir.
And get something that can be applicable to Guyana.
Thank you.
But I have a feel of it. I don't want to take up any more time, but regrettably,
the time for doing it
is so short because, quite frankly,
Esteemed Commissioner,
it's something I would like to have delved into. Go ahead, Mr.
Just one thing, sir. You're right, we can build on what we have currently.
All right, that basically was what transpired. And of course, after all of this, Justice Cecil Kennard indeed offered an opportunity to withdraw and continue the testimony.
No, in fact, he didn't offer an opportunity to withdraw. He said to Mr. Hughes, would you like to continue
the testimony?
The cross-examination. And he said he wanted Mr. Yusuf for his own, Kennard's own information. Least it be said, he was not given an opportunity to represent adequately his clients. And Nigel Hughes, subsequent to that, withdrew and went and had this press conference claiming that he was denied to fully represent his clients. And I say this is the arrogance of the people we're dealing with. Could you imagine them being in government, how they'll treat our people?
But as a legal expert, such comment being used in what could be deemed an ideal court setting from an attorney to a lawyer, up to a witness?
The persons who comprise this commission, as I said, are persons of impeccable integrity, persons who have held the highest judicial offices in countries. And what you saw there was a most reprehensible violation of etiquette, of ethics, of all the canons of the legal profession. What you saw there was a violation of the high tradition by which the bar is bound in the execution of the bar's function. The word nobility is associated for centuries and has been associated for centuries with the legal profession. One is expected to conduct oneself with a requisite degree of nobility and honor, and that is why it is called the honorable profession. And that is why you're required to say learned when you refer to a lawyer, when a lawyer refers to a lawyer. What you saw there by Mr. Hughes was a catapulting, an overturn of all those very sacrosanct precepts which are connected to the legal profession. And to crown it off, he attempted to be so facetious to the tribunal by pretending to not remember what he just said, when he forgot, so involved is he in himself, that he forgot that the thing is verbatim recorded, the proceedings, as well as there are about 15 cameras rolling simultaneously and continuously, recording every single thing that is being said. And what is worse is that I believe, and I have the evidence to show, that I believe that this whole thing, his exit from the commission, is one that was orchestrated and preconceived. And what we saw there was an execution of a preconceived plan. Why do I say so? His sidekick, Mark Benchcup, almost contemporaneous with that regrettable exchange between him and the commission, contemporaneous with that, Mark Benchcup, who is a sidekick of Nigel Hughes, posted on his internet page a very derogatory statement about Mr. K.D. Knights and Mr. Wolf, that they are corrupt and things to that effect. Mr. Hughes, apparently, whilst he was there, said on that posting that he is finished with the commission. At that time, he was still seated in the commission. He had not yet announced his decision to withdraw from the commission. So this whole thing, in my view, seemed to be a prearranged plan and then begun on the internet, a whole host of exchanges and flow of views, all seeking to denigrate and insult the integrity of those people.
So this happened before all of this?
It commenced before, and it accelerated when Mr. Hughes withdrew himself. It commenced before, and he put a posting up before he actually withdrew. So I am saying to you, as a result of his consistent and constant abject failures in this commission, and hence the reason why I recited those whole list of events, because of those failures, he wanted a way out. He wanted a way out.
And that is how, or perhaps to go to the second agenda that they have. And that is, if this thing is inconclusive in terms of what they're putting up for their own followers, then they initiate another agenda.
You are absolutely correct, Mansoor, because I said, and I've been asked to brief the president and HPS on a regular basis and my cabinet colleagues, and I've been saying to them that we have to prepare ourselves for the commission now being the subject of attack, because as I was briefing them of how the evidence is unfolding and how the opposition's contentions are being dismantled and disproved, that we will have these consequences. And it began like a few days ago with persons trying to writing in the newspapers, attacking the integrity of the personnel who comprise of the commission, attacking the commission itself. And what this is showing is that the AFC, and the AFC, well, this gentleman is the chairman, so I can't see how they can disassociate themselves. The AFC...
And the vice chairman sits next to him.
And the vice chairman sits next to him.
Yes.
What the AFC is now demonstrating is that they don't want law and order. They don't want to lend themselves and support to civilized legal tribunals and civilized way and democratic way of settling disputes. That is not their approach. They are demonstrating day by day that they are an extremist organization, and they are resorting every day to extremist type political strategies and tactics. This here, the attempt to denigrate this commission and the commissioners, is another attempt, another illustration of that strategy. That strategy of extremism as a political tool.
And A.G., Edward, that is not far-fetched. That scenario which the A.G. is outlining is not far-fetched. Because when you look at what Nigel Hughes said when he was giving the ultimatum, he called for mass protests. And the subsequent to that, at the fish shop meeting that he had, he called for people to take justice in their own hands, literally.
He said he's not calling for peace.
Literally. So this is not something far-fetched which we are not informed about. The signs are there. Just as they're setting up the signs to reject the Commission of Inquiry report, just as they're setting up the attacks on the commissioners themselves, so they've already have hatched these issues to create chaos in our society.
Maybe if I could take you back a little. If we were to look at what happened today at the commission, and to maybe go back to the ultimatum, those meetings, the agricultural protest, etc., do you think someone saw the direction in which
I don't think someone saw. They knew that they were peddling lies from the beginning, not seeing with it. They knew what they were peddling from the very beginning was untruths, unjustified. And that is, as I said earlier in this program, is unraveling right now. They knew that. They thought that they would have used all the legal gymnastics and the courtroom drama to intimidate people. But if a person is going to stand in the stand and speak from the experience and from the heart and from what is right and what they did, then no amount of lies. Like yesterday, he was trying to say to Minister Rohee, but you didn't give them didn't speak to the commissioner specifically about not shooting. When the Home Affairs Minister said he had a meeting with the commissioner prior to the July 17 protest, and he was trying now to say, but you didn't tell him don't shoot people. And Minister Stock, my briefing was, execute your orders, we have standard operating procedures, blah, blah, blah. Right? So, for me, they have peddled all these untruths, they have made all these false accusations. They vilified Minister Rohee, as he said. Minister said in the stand. And now all of that is unraveling before them. But it's not so much the unraveling. It's what the overwhelming majority of the Guyanese people have now learnt about them. The overwhelming majority of the Guyanese people, A.G., are now seeing through them. And this is part of the issue. And it's going to be like a drowning man clutching at straws.
Yeah, they are going to get more and more desperate. Take, for example, yesterday, another furore was created by Mr. Hughes. He says that he has this YouTube video which is going to contradict Mr. Minister Rohee in this fundamental way. And he produced a video. And it was a video of yourself interviewing Minister Rohee. Yeah. And Minister Rohee said in that video that he extracted from the police commissioner an undertaking that they will not use deadly force at Linden and so on. So that was, to the benefit of Mr. Rohee. So everything he has produced inured to the benefit, or rather, was against himself and the case that he sought to represent. And therefore, you have this culmination of which eventually led to his withdrawal. But more fundamentally, the Guyanese people who voted for the AFC and who supported the AFC must now really examine where they stand, do some degree of introversion, do some degree of self-examination, and see whether or not they are going to continue in this path of self-destruction that the AFC is on, a path that is not only self-destructive to the AFC, but one that they want to destroy the country with. But the civilized Guyanese population, and they number the majority, are not going to be part of this avalanche of destruction upon which the AFC has embarked. And I hope that people recognize that quickly and disengage themselves.
H.E., they have been. I want to be fair to the overwhelming majority of good, rational, decent Guyanese. They have been. Because the 35,000 odd people who voted for the AFC thought that the AFC would bring independent reason, rationalism, country force thinking to the politics of this country. Not what was, because, and I am out there every single day interacting with all shades and colors.
I have two more things I quickly want us to touch. One, based on what is coming out at the Commission of Inquiry, it was already established that the police didn't fire those live rounds in Linden. So and the minister was in no way involved as it relates to give any instructions to shoot or anything of that sort. But the big question, because quite a number of persons going in front of the commission talking about compensation. Maybe we can talk a little briefly about who exactly will be compensating.
That's a good one, A.G.
Well, the question was raised. It's not a concept to which the commission has not adverted its attention to, because today the commission, at the commencement of its hearing, asked that question of Mr. Basil Williams. The question was, assuming, because at this stage they can only assume, the commission's work is ongoing, assuming that the police is held not responsible, or the police is not held responsible for the happenings at Linden, so by extension, the state is not held responsible for what happened at Linden, who will pay the compensation? And Mr. Williams was shocked. He was caught off guard. He said that he didn't address his mind to it. He advanced the reason that he didn't address his mind to it because, according to him, there is clear circumstantial evidence that the police is involved and is implicated. Now, in that answer that he gave is the admission that there is no direct evidence. So half of the battle already is lost. He is admitting that there is no direct evidence, so that their entire case from his mouth is one that is based on circumstantial evidence. The commission further pointed out to him that, look, Mr. Williams, you don't have to determine that. We have to determine whether there is the evidence or not, circumstantial or otherwise. So what would be the position if we are to find this way? Again, he said that, well, you know, I didn't address my mind to that. I have to get back to you on that. So the point is, it's a fundamental question. Because not only have people been injured and people been shot, you have the issue of the hundreds of millions of dollars of properties which have been destroyed, including state properties. Who are going to pay for that?
Well, we will have to come Parliament, down. We heard one of the pastors from Linden, who is a member of Parliament, said he led 40 church leaders.
Also, you heard Ms. Vanessa Kisoon, another member of Parliament, who said very clearly in her evidence to the commission that blocking of the bridge was unlawful, that they had no reason to block the bridge. We know that blocking of every public thoroughfare and every public roadway and every public bridge is a criminal act, is a criminal trespass, and it constitutes several offenses under the Road Traffic Act and the various pieces of criminal legislation. So that by itself is criminal. And she accepted that it is criminal. So you have an admission from the leadership of the people, because she professed to have been a leader of those people. And she's saying
it was
that,
illegal.
That their procession on the bridge is illegal, that they did not march within the time permitted by the police, and also that their blocking of the bridge was an unlawful act. So the leader of the grouping is admitting to illegality. So it's a very, very complex question which will have to deal with.
Fine. Let's say at the end of this entire process, it comes out that the police are found to be guilty of firing these shots. Let's say that's the end.
Yeah.
The state has to compensate the persons who were injured and the relatives of those who were killed.
And those who may have lost property.
What about who's going to compensate the state for those buildings?
And not only the state, who will also compensate the man whose lorry was burnt, the man whose excavator was overturned and damaged and burnt. The PPP office, that's not a state. The PPP office was burnt. And the
logs, etc.
Logs and so on, which were destroyed. Who are going to compensate those people? And the state, as you mentioned. We may have to hold another inquiry to determine who will compensate.
Well, Edward, I don't know about another inquiry. I know with the nimbleness of mind and the legal mind that the AG has, I am not dismissing the fact that I'm sure that at the end of this, you will see some private charges being laid against several people who were the heart of and the leadership of that protest. I remember something unheard of in the labor history here in Guyana. We had a running battle between one bauxite union and a company.
Yeah.
And the company has actually filed a suit in court against the union for damages, because there was a similar situation, riots and so on, damage to the...
Yeah.
So I am expecting that there are going to be several cases that will come up against those who led, supported, and are accountable for the destruction in Linden.
And what is also significant before we wrap up is that those who loudly proclaimed to the commission on the oath that they were the leaders, they will have to face the consequences because they were the leaders and they said so on the oath. I don't know on what basis they will now extricate themselves from those grand proclamations which they made. If you are leading, then you are vicariously liable for your flock. That is the law. So it's a very interesting development which we will have to address.
Honourable Ananandalal, Minister of Legal Affairs and Attorney General, Mr. Manzoor Nadir, PVP Member of Parliament. Gentlemen, I want to thank you very much for this discussion. I know we could have kept going, but in the interest of time, this is where we have to wrap things up. I want to thank you very much again for joining us, and I want to thank you very much
for
being a part of this program. Stand by, the NCN 8 Edition News is next.